Welcome to today's webinar, COVID-19 Testing Toolkit Webinar Series, Lessons from the Entertainment Industry, Testing as a Mitigation Strategy to Get Back on Set. Dr. Gigi Granval will now begin.
Thank you all for joining us today. I'm Gigi Granval, Senior Scholar at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security and an Associate Professor at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Today is our third installment of the webinar series on COVID-19 testing strategies featuring best practices from leaders. This webinar series can be found on our COVID-19 testing toolkit, which is available online, and we'll put the link in the chat. The toolkit provides essential information for organizations of all sizes seeking to develop or adapt their COVID-19 testing strategies to fit their needs. Testing, as you know, is crucial to stopping the spread of SARS-CoV-2. Whether taking a test prescribed by your doctor, picking up a test from a pharmacy, or choosing a test for your employees, it's important to choose the right type of test to provide the most useful information. Testing services are also now available that offer tests and testing strategies to organizations. So our toolkit gives you information about all the different kinds of tests, the testing services, and everything else to help you figure out a good strategy. This project is funded by the Lyda Hill Philanthropies and the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation. After this panel, we're going to answer questions from the audience. So please submit questions in the Q&A box. We will answer as many questions as possible. Today, we are talking with Meredith Lavender and Marcy Yulin. Meredith and Marcy have been business partners for over 15 years and have worked together as executive producers and showrunners for productions including HBO Max's The Flight Attendant, ABC's Nashville, Fox's Proven Innocent, and The Gifted, among others. So Meredith and Marcy will provide insights into how they use testing as one of the public health tools to resume production safely. Meredith, over to you.
Thank you so much, Gigi, and thank you for having both of us here today. We want to lead by saying that the thoughts and ideas that we are sharing today are anecdotal from our experience and not necessarily representative of the studio itself. We wanted to be able to share kind of almost the frontline experience we had taking a big crew back into production. So just wanted to leave with that. We thought it'd be helpful to provide a little bit of context for what a normal day in production would look like in order to kind of help people grasp the, you know, not magnitude, but the magnitude for in our world of getting things back up and running production. So essentially on any given day, there's about 13 hours of work that get done if you're running on a true schedule. You'll hear stories of people working 16 hour days. That's usually when things aren't going very well. But that includes 12 hours of work and an hour for lunch. And that is all under union guidelines, all the different unions that get represented in production. We have anywhere from, I would say a light day on set would be around, you know, maybe 100 people. In the TV world, a big day on set might be, you know, 300 people. And then if you have something really extraordinary, like we did on Nashville sometimes, you can have 700 or 800 people on set if you're doing a big concert scene and you have, you know, 500 extras, et cetera, to kind of fill in the crowd. So you can have a lot of people on set at any given point in time. On any given day, the way the workday starts is you have your crew usually shows up at the same time your actors show up to start their process, and crew is doing everything from rigging lights, set dressing. Sometimes there's construction going on for future work, and all these things kind of happen simultaneously with the entire crew working in their different sections on your soundstage at any given point during the day. That happens multiple times throughout the day. You'll have people working, you know, versus shooting versus being quiet if they're shooting. And then on location, you have the same kind of thing. You load in, people are loading in, they're setting up, they're getting ready to shoot, they're putting lights in, they're getting the cameras into the location and ready to work. So you have a lot of people coming and going and moving around. Mars?
So a normal, like typical actor's journey through their morning would be the actor would, some actors drive themselves to set, some are picked up by transpo and brought to set. They usually go straight into hair and makeup where they're interacting with their hair and makeup people. And that's clearly a lot of directly in people's faces time. Then they tend to go to set for a rehearsal, and rehearsals happen in waves. So you'll have your actors come in and they'll usually do a private rehearsal first of whatever scene is up first of the day that involves the actor, the director, the writer, the producer that's there on set, and you kind of walk through and figure out exactly how they're going to block and shoot the scene, where the cameras are going to go, where the actors are going to be, and everything else. And then there's a second rehearsal that happens where you open it up and truly almost every department head comes in and usually stands around the edges and watches, because they have to be able to get everything set up while the actor finishes their process. So then the actor leaves and goes back to hair, makeup, wardrobe. And while they're gone, the crew has the set. And it's usually, so that's all of our lighting techs and sound, and everyone is coming in, the camera departments, and getting everything set up on top of each other, so that then by the time they're finished and the actors are ready, the actors come back to set, the crew hands the set over and they step off and the actors are on and we're ready to roll.
So suffice it to say, there's a lot of cross-pollinating that happens in the world of production. You have a lot of people coming and going. Set has always been an open and very free-moving place. You know, you're not thinking about how you have to subdivide people out, because really the only thing that has to happen when the cameras roll is it needs to be quiet for sound. So that's really kind of the one. Other than that, people are often, even when cameras are rolling, people are moving around on the stages, doing things, getting food, you know, whatever. So there's figuring out how to go back to work when, you know, once the pandemic hit, and figuring out how to create a safe environment when you have that much cross-pollination happening, that many people needing to come and go. It wasn't quite the same conundrum as a classroom or people who go into individual offices. I would equate it a little bit more probably to the experience of trying to put factories or warehouses back into a safe environment, because there is so much movement throughout the day. And the thing about a crew is you're all on top of each other. When you think, you know, you've probably seen, you know, the making of a TV show or a movie, you know, if you're the camera operator and you're operating the camera, you've got a dolly grip right behind you who's pushing the dolly, and your focus puller's right in front of you. And you guys are all probably sharing, I don't know, merged 3 feet of space at most. I mean, it's a very intimate environment. And then add to that that everybody eats lunch together, craft service, which is kind of snacks and drinks throughout the day, sit out and people congregate around that, because again, by union rule, there has to be those things made available to people. So suddenly you have anywhere from like 100 to, let's call it 800 individuals, so ergo their families, jammed together in a location. So we really had to like pull back and figure out how do we do this and how do we do this safely.
Yeah, so figuring out how to put the crew back to work, just, it was a lot of moving pieces. And then for what we do, there was the added tricky component of there comes a point in time when the actors could not be wearing PPE. So our crews ended up wearing PPE basically the whole time, but there's a certain stretch of time that the actors would hit where they truly had to remove absolutely everything to be able to interact with each other on set, to be able to interact with hair and makeup and for those touch-ups and everything else. So hence, we had to develop a testing strategy to help us let everybody feel they were going to be safe. So some of the shows that we know, that we had friends who were working on, did the thing where they basically went and built like a bubble, where they took their entire cast, their entire crew, they went to one location and they basically locked down and treated it like it was summer camp, like the way that I know some of the sports leagues built that, like, here's the section and nobody kind of comes in or out. But for a lot of other shows, that just wasn't possible or practical. Like for us, we were going back to locations that we'd already had running. We were in New York City. Like there was a lot of, there were a lot of other components that we did not have the capacity to say, we're gonna take everybody and just go lock into a place. So pretty much every studio ended up implementing both a tiered testing plan, which I'm gonna let Lab talk about in a minute about how many times a week different groups were tested, and a pod system that we put into place to kind of end up breaking up, as Lab said, that 100 to 800 people who were going to be there into manageable groups so that we could kind of have contact, we could contact trace with ease if we needed to. So we were one of the very first shows that ended up going back in and kind of ended up paving the way with putting these systems all in place. So
the way we did it was, I'll talk about the pod system first, because it's what many places are doing, and it's, I think, relatively self-explanatory, but it's the idea that there were zones within the structure of the studio space or the location. So, you know, we called the red zone the closest to camera zone, and that was our zone, that was where our actors were, and it was a red zone because very few people were allowed in it because actors would be without masks, et cetera, et cetera. So it was only really essential personnel there. And then as you tiered out, you know, there was a yellow zone, there were green zones that were a little, you know, maybe outside or a little easier to move around and through. So we created zones, and then within that we created pods. So ordinarily, as I said earlier, you would have like, you might have construction working first thing in the morning and your rigging grips would be on set, you know, hanging lights or doing some, or rigging things for the day. Your lighting crew would be there, your set deck crew would be there. We had to figure out how to say, okay, what pod can be in there and then get out and then not be in there for a while? And then who's the next pod that can go in and which two pods could be there at the same time? So we figured out a whole system of, okay, here are small, you know, departmental groups of people such that if there was any issue within that pod, we could shut the pod down. We know a lot of schools are doing this. My kid's school did the same thing. You can shut down that pod, contact trace accordingly, and keep moving by bringing in kind of either people that were not affected who were capable of doing the job and could move up for a few days, or in some cases we had to go outside of our production and find somebody with the skill set and bring them in. So that was one way we kind of set up our contact tracing / workflow, which was, you know, is challenging because it's not what anyone's used to. And then the second thing we did was essentially went through what PPE was worn by whom and where and why. Because our makeup and hair people get the closest to our actors, they were kind of the most fortified. They had gowns, they had gloves, they had masks, they had everything. Everybody, of course, had masks. Many people chose to wear masks and shields or eyewear. But we had to really kind of be very conscientious about hair and makeup folks who get so close to the actors unmasked. Then we basically put in a system of testing. So the way we did it on our show was three tests a week. We did, everyone had to get tested who was inside essentially, I think yellow zones, Mars. I think it was yellow and red, had to get tested three times a week. There were two rapid tests and one PCR. That's how we handled kind of dividing out, trying to catch anything you could catch and always doing a weekly PCR. People that were less on set or could be on set and leave, or like our construction crews, we tested them once a week because they had easier time social distancing, their workload. There were fewer people on set if it was just the construction crew. So we were able to create an environment like that within, you know, each department, kind of determine how much you got tested or didn't get tested. Anecdotally, one of the funniest things that's kind of came up in the process is that like all PPE is not created equal for all jobs. And I'm sure many people are seeing this in different environments. In our case, for example, if you have a cameraman and he can wear a shield, that's great. But suddenly when that person goes to what we call handheld, which is literally picking up the camera and holding the camera as opposed to it being, you know, set on a dolly or on what we call sticks, meaning not moving, that becomes a problem because then they need to be able to actually look through into the camera to see what the camera is seeing. And suddenly that shield doesn't work, nor does protective eyewear. So we had a bunch of people like very coolly like figure out, and this happened on many productions, not just ours, but they figured out how to like take ski goggles or swimming goggles and do a one goggle thing with one eye open. I mean, there's a lot of ingenuity that came out of it, but we had to get really creative because depending on what people needed, we had to kind of adjust accordingly, but at the same time, make sure they were safe.
Yeah, and I mean, we were lucky, it ended up working. We never lost a day of shooting. We never had to shut down the entire unit. We only had like 20, 25 days to get in the can, but we've had friends that have truly had shows up that they've been running for this whole long stretch of time that have been in production for months now. And the pod system combined with testing has really, really worked well for the industry where it's, they get, if somebody does get a positive, they get to contact trace, that little pod, that little unit gets sent home to wait out their quarantine period until they get healthy. They bring in a backup crew and so that the everything can keep running as smoothly as it possibly can. And, you know, now we're at this place where with the vaccine rolling out, like we're gonna see what the policies end up being. A lot of those are going to be set at the like studio and union level, like those negotiations are happening and then those mandates are getting passed down to the shows. So it's going to be interesting to see what policies end up getting put into place and sticking around. But we're hearing that most studios are leaning towards continuing testing protocols for at least the rest of this year, even with the vaccine rollout. I mean, that could change at any time, but you know, given what we're seeing, even with things like Major League Baseball and the Yankees and those kind of things, it's like the testing has been a great way to keep everything running smoothly and give everyone peace of mind when they're coming to work to be able to do their jobs.
Yeah, and for us especially, like the entertainment industry, it's a gig economy. We are all, you know, we don't go to work, we don't get paid. That's literally from the highest top actor you can think of down to the PA on set who's, you know, first job ever in the business or second or third job ever in the business. And so for us, like we were in the position, our crew wanted to go back to work. There was a real push. Everybody wanted to go back to work. So we didn't feel like the sense or scope of fear, but it was the thing of how do we do this and how do we achieve safety? And how do we have an environment where people know that they are safe and are being looked after? Because for Marcy and me, that was paramount to anything else. Of course, we wanted to finish the show. Of course, we wanted the world to see the show. But at the end of the day, if we couldn't do it safely, we had, you know, for us, you know, that wouldn't have worked very well for us. Let's just say that. And as Marcy said, we'll look ahead. We'll see what happens and with protocols and how they change, not only for our industry, but for the whole kind of the whole world, right? But it won't be surprising to us if the studios do want to continue testing. And I think that will become the real question of like, how do you do testing where it doesn't eat up kind of the entire load-in process of the day? Because that's one thing I didn't say, that when we were looking in the mornings and we had the rapid testing and the people had to come in, they had to test, they had to wait 15 minutes, and that was eating up time in our day. And then also because of COVID, we had to do shorter shooting hours. That was just one of the deals that the union had made with the studios. And so all of a sudden you're losing test time to testing, and then you've already lost time. So you're really having to jam pack your days in a different way, which is hard. That's challenging. So I think people will be looking for ways for testing to be easy, quick, whether it's at home. Is it the spit test? Is there some other kind of rapid test that we just don't know about yet that people can just, oh, look, I did it, and it's in my app now, and I'm negative, and I'm good, you know? So I think that'll be something that the studios will be, you know, have an eye to until, an eye towards until things are different universally. So.
Can you say a little bit more about because when this was being filmed, this was at a pretty scary time. Were people, how were they like scared about the testing? Were people reassured? Is it normalized? How long did that take?
I mean, I think it was a little bit of both. I mean, we'll be honest. We've all been living through this, right? Like it was scary, and the uncertainty is part of what made it scary. And I think the testing helped everyone feel like they had a backstop, you know, where you're trusting everyone that you're working with and leaning into that kind of space. But it gave everybody the feeling that they knew they were going to be here. They knew that the people that they were working with, that everyone was looking out for each other, and had, if God forbid, somebody came back with a positive, that there were protocols and systems in place to keep it from becoming that community spread and turning into suddenly, you know, everyone on set got sick or something like that, which of course, when we look back at it, you're like, the way that a set normally ran, we would never have been able to go back to work. Because for us, it was like our show, we shut down, this is every show in the business, shut down for like a decent stretch of time over last summer to figure out how were we going to do this in a way that allowed people to come back to work. And nothing went back up until, you know, the fall were the first kind of shows that came back in. We all shut down kind of in March and didn't come back up until the fall, where they'd had time to figure out and work through, like, how are these testing strategies going to work and how are these pod systems going to work?
We were also reliant on, you know, governors being willing to open up states to certain numbers of people gathering, because obviously you heard us talking about, oh, we have, you know, 150 people on set, and New York rolled it out a little bit in waves. So like our very first day of filming, we were allowed to, I think, have 100 people on set. So we had to go with a really slimmed down crew. And then we were allowed, funnily enough, because we started on August 31st, then September 1st, we were allowed to go up, I think, to like 150 or 200. And then at some point it became, you know, the numbers didn't matter if you had protocols in place. The way we were able to kind of do things, though, is that we had actually machines that were ours, dedicated to us, in a dedicated space on our stages. So we were able to run our own testing kind of protocol, like in-house, essentially, mm-hmm. I don't know that it would have been possible to do it any other way, because we had to have total control of that situation in order to accomplish not losing hours and hours and hours and days and days and that kind of thing.
Did you do symptom screening as well, or just the testing?
We did symptom screening for sure. I think at testing, I think everyone was asked the questions, you know, and everyone was at that point also just coming back in August. Everyone was highly aware of the kind of symptoms. So I think that if anything happened, I think anyone saw somebody.
And we were doing like temperature screenings when people showed up and that kind of thing, and that you were answering the questions of, you know, I've been asymptomatic. It's the same kind of thing. It's really fun. It's the same thing we're doing with our kids going back to school now.
Right.
It's the same kind of daily check to be like, yes, this temperature check. And then also knowing that there was the stop of 1 to 3 tests a week, again, depending on which zone you were in.
Do you think it's going to influence the way that scripts are written to kind of accommodate the smaller?
Yes. I think for the foreseeable future, until things are more normal, or, you know, you don't have to follow as strict a protocol, 100%. I mean, you're seeing it. For those of you out there who watch, you know, for example, a bunch of CBS shows, their actors are wearing masks this season, and that's on some of the more like legal procedural stuff or things where it's okay to be part of the story because it's, you know, it's operating in the world as if it's today, those kinds of stories. It's a little harder with something like The Flight Attendant to suddenly have Cassie in a mask, the main character. But I do think you're gonna see, it'll be interesting to watch, I think, looking back when we look at TV over these kind of 2 years, to see scenes that suddenly could have been one version of the scene that are much smaller with fewer extras. We did have, one of the things we had to do was decide kind of what was the most number of extras we needed. And we actually had a pool of extras that we kept on hand for the whole 30 days. And we just moved them around, and, you know, if it was your face today, it's your back tomorrow or whatever, because we had to, normally you would have different extras every day. We couldn't do that, obviously. We needed to have a pool of folks we could kind of keep the same beat on that we were keeping on our crew and our actors. So
we've had a lot of friends who have worked on shows, different kind of shows than ours, but that are a little bit more effects heavy and that kind of stuff, and they've said they're leaning a lot more on their effects, a lot more on their replacements of backgrounds and building crowds and tiling. Like we used to do this a lot when we were on Nashville, when like when we were shooting concert scenes and stuff, where it would be like the first 100 people you were seeing were real, and then you would start to build out with computer models and stuff. And that is becoming a lot more widespread for anybody who's having to do any kind of crowd work and that sort of stuff. And the way that those programs have evolved over the last decade too is amazing.
Yeah, thankfully.
So that goes for shooting on location as well, right?
Yeah, so we lost a couple of our locations, understandably, and they were established locations. So we either had to build something on our set that could replicate it enough to get away with it. We had to change the location of that particular story piece, which in some cases is easy and in some cases is hard. But in locations we would run into, for example, there's a big scene in episode 8 that we shot at the Jarvis Center. We shot it as an airport, actually. But even in a space as massive as the atrium at the Jarvis Center, you know, we had a limited number of extras we were allowed to have at any given point in time. So, you know, places that didn't want us to come back, you know, it's, again, you totally understand, but it, you know, it was hard for us, but we got it. We understood why. But, you know, look, you tack accordingly, and part of producing anything in movie, TV, music, video, anything, part of it is just being nimble. It's being, your job is literally to solve problems. That's Marcy and my job by trade, other than writing words. We then, once the words are written, we solve problems. And that's what you spend your day doing. And as a creative storyteller, you look at any given scene and you say, okay, what's the essence of the scene? Okay, if I can't do it on a boat because it's raining and it's not safe for the crew, can I get the same thing conveyed if we're like standing in a boathouse? Yes, I can. Okay, great. That's an easy change. So it's the benefit of having creatives involved in the producing and problem solving. We were able to, you know, to tack accordingly. But I think locations will be a challenge, continue to be a challenge going forward until people are more comfortable and people feel that the vaccines are, you know, doing everything that they have been doing and that they're working and that, you know, we're seeing a real curtail of the disease, of the virus. So
yeah, I mean, and we also, you know, the we we have worked on many, many shows where we travel a lot. And in a traditional way, when you're shooting a television show, a lot of times what happens is your director's only coming in for that one episode. Your writers are only coming in for that episode. You have actors who are coming in for a day or 5 days or that kind of thing. And that has been very challenging to try to figure out how to work around those sorts of limitations, because there's not the same in and out. You know, like even when we first stood this back up, it was that place of like people were quarantining in New York for 2 weeks before they could even go be on set and join the pods and stuff if you were coming from outside of New York State. And so that's been a huge shift.
Going through that right now, all of our friends who are in Canada, they're the same issue right now, because Canada's quarantines are incredibly, their rules are really stringent right now. It's a 3 days before you land test at the airport. You have to go to a government sanctioned hotel until you get your second negative, and then it's still 14 days total in quarantine, wherever you can quarantine safely. And so that affects production too, right? I mean, my mother-in-law just went through it. She had been here and she went back to Canada where she's from, but same with production. Any actor who's going to Canada right now has to do that. So then production has to take on the cost of that, the time structure of that and what that does. And when you're asking somebody to come in, it gets a little trickier. You know, so unless it's a big role, it's like in most cases now, it's stuff that you might've flown an American actor up, you're casting a Canadian local, which isn't a bad thing. It's good for Canadian local talent.
Does that affect like, you know, the kind of the lifestyle of, you know, where people might go with their families for the whole production, or, you know, sometimes doesn't this take months?
Yeah, a lot of times it does. And again, we've had friends who have contemplated taking jobs outside of the US, but they've realized that there's an openness to visas for certain workers, but not the extended tourist visa that like your family used to get. So people who are like, oh, I don't want to go necessarily take a job where I'm going to be gone for a year, they're having to weigh that out. Do I go and leave my family for a year? Or do I not take the job? And that's definitely been, I think, something that a lot of people are weighing as they try to contemplate that. But yes, the notion of, do you just pick up your whole family and go, and you're going to go live someplace else for a long extended period of time? Because it's not as easy to bounce back and forth to be like, well, I'm going to be on set from Monday through Thursday, and then I'm going to go home for the weekends. And it's a big shift.
Did you have any problems like with false positives during the time that you were shooting?
We can't really say there were problems because the way our protocol was, a positive was a positive, even if it was a false positive. We got lucky in that nobody got sick on our show, but we had a few times that folks had to go home. And then with follow-up subsequent testing, it was proven to have been a false positive, but the unions had to make a decision. And I think it was the right decision at the time, especially with still, when we were back in, vaccines were still a question mark of, was it going to be late 19 or 20? We just didn't know. And so I think the answer, or late 20, excuse me, I don't even know what year it is anymore. I've lost my mind. I literally don't know where we are in time and space anymore. No, but the point being that that wasn't rolling out. It was still a question when it was going to roll out, you know, if it was late 20 or early 21. And so we just had to have a hard line and approach it that way. So if the answer was, if the test came back and it was positive, you went home, and that was just what it was.
Did it end up that you had like more people involved or less people, like when you had to have extra crew members, did it end up being, you know, about the same number, or how did that change like the actual numbers of people that you had?
A couple things that I can answer. One, we definitely had a few extra people because each show has a COVID officer now. So it's actually somebody, usually somebody from the medical field who comes onto the show to oversee the whole process of everything to do with COVID. And also then that person is making sure that protocol is being followed, whether testing or PPE or anything else, or distancing or anything else. We definitely, in some cases, had fewer people because if we were going into a location, we normally would have been able to walk in with like 150 people, and that location said you can only have 100 people. Well, we can't say like, we'll do half the extras if we need all the extras. So in that case, you might have like a slimmed down camera crew or a slimmed down grip or electric crew, you know, it depends. I wouldn't say it was, for our show in particular, I wouldn't say it was an overwhelming swing any one way or the other. I know some other shows probably more so they slimmed down as much as they could just to get back in. Because especially shows like LA had different rules than New York, had different rules from Atlanta, had different rules from Chicago. So you kind of had to just roll with it wherever you could. So, but at our show in particular didn't feel like like it impacted us that much.
There's a question about like the cadence of the testing and like how that was negotiated and whether that is there going to be sort of an industry best practice on that? Like, you know, you mentioned that it was dictated by union requirements that you did testing 3 times a week. Do you see that changing? And also who paid for the tests? I know that in some locations it was probably free, but picked up by the state, or was it picked up by the studio?
The studio paid for everything for us. The studio paid for everything because now the shows pay for everything, which is really the studios paying for everything.
The studios,
It's the same money. So the studios pay for it. I don't, that's a good question about the cadence. I wonder, Mars, I'm gonna say this as a question and curious your thoughts. I wonder with the vaccine, if that might change, and this is me truly wondering, maybe it changes protocol, maybe once a week becomes a standard, maybe I don't know. I think that's gonna be a kind of wait and see, because it's also the question that I don't think unions or studios necessarily will make vaccines mandatory, and that I have no finger on the pulse on that other than to say I just don't know that that's what will happen. So if that doesn't happen, I think you probably have to keep testing in place in some capacity. Don't you agree, Mars?
Yeah, I think so, because I think that it's, and again, as we all know, there's so many ripple effects that go with that and what the policies are, but I think it's going to be, it will be negotiated between the studios and the unions is my knee jerk on that, to make sure that everybody feels like they are protected and covered. And then that will be kind of the policy that rolls forward, but it's going to live at that level, not really on like an individual show level.
And I think if you made me in this moment pick, I would say it would not be less than one. And I don't expect it would go to more than 3, since that kind of became the industry. That did kind of become the standard. Mm-hmm. But again, that one is, that's a treat. Again, union bosses and studio heads and heads of production, good luck.
But you had, you didn't really have, I'm trying to think about if there were any children on the set, but I mean, certainly there's gonna be shows that have kids that can't even be vaccinated yet.
Right.
We have 2 kids on our set.
That's right.
Young Davey, young Cassidy, they follow the same testing thing. Their parents agreed to it. They had to test the same as anybody else.
But to your point about the vaccine, Gigi, it's like, exactly. It's like there are people who can't get vaccinated for whatever reasons. There's people who aren't, within the age requirements and like all of those things. So, like we said, our understanding right now is that a lot of studios are saying that basically like they're just going to continue these for the foreseeable future, right? Like that this is how they're going to be handling this.
Yeah.
So somebody asks, how did you handle CLIA? And I'm not sure what...
I don't think it's a funny thing is I know what CLIA is only because my husband's a PhD.
Oh, the clinical, I was thinking it was an acronym from your world and not from mine, but yes, I do know what CLIA is.
It's a clinical lab accreditation.
Right.
In our case, I think it's because we were working with a testing company and then we had a registered nurse on site doing all of the actual testing, whatever. So we were in conjunction with a testing company, it was a testing company and then an actual, like we had medical professionals handling all of that. So,
right.
So we didn't have to have an actual proper, we didn't have to set up a CLIA lab. Thank goodness, my husband has set up 2 of those. I'm glad we didn't have to. And kudos to everybody out there who has done that.
No, the CLIA waiver is an important part of this process.
For sure.
Did you collect statistics, or is anybody collecting statistics about any of, are studios looking like what has worked and what doesn't, and if there's any best practices that are emerging?
If they are, they haven't told us. Interestingly, if there was a great public health reason to collect that information, somebody should raise their hand and go talk to Hollywood, but that functions above our heads from where we sit on shows.
Mm-hmm. Do you think people will want to have some sort of card that identifies, you know, that they're vaccinated? Do people talk about like the vaccine issue? Like, I'm ready to work. I'm vaccinated.
That's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. I think, you know, people, if social media is any indication, it feels like most people out there are pretty psyched and letting the world know they've been vaccinated. So I think if it's about coming back to work, then again, I don't know that they'll be able to make that mandatory between, you know, unions and studios and liabilities and rules and people's rights and HIPAA and all that. I'm not sure how they're going to handle that, because that, I think that's where HIPAA becomes actually an interesting wicket in the wheel.
Was there ever a problem before COVID that you could think of where, like, you know, productions had problems because of illness? I'm wondering, you know, is there going to be some expectation, like, this is a variable that maybe we can control, like, to keep flu off the set? Or is that something, or people are just not there yet?
I mean, I can't think of anything that falls in this category.
I hope people will, as somebody who often starts off every writer's room by telling people if they feel crappy to stay home, because let's not have like the universal cold that fires around the writer's room. My hope is that we've all learned a little bit about that, and that we, you know, people listen to their bodies a little bit more, and that also work environments create a slightly better situation for people to be allowed to be sick, you know, because it does happen. So yeah, but I can't think of anything either offhand.
Okay.
Yeah.
What what were some of the most fun experiences then? I mean, you had were people feeling like they didn't get the full experience of the show, or, you know, cause there is that like separation and pods, or did it work out?
I think people were just really happy to be back at work. I mean, like I said, these are people who, if they don't work, they don't get paid. And I think people were really, you know, yeah, it wasn't, we talked to our friends who were crew, and it was, you know, everyone said it's weird. And, you know, you don't just sit around, you know, it's not the kind of, laid back's not the right word, but just kind of free flowing, creative jam that production can be. And that part was definitely weird, but I think people were just so happy to be back in, especially for us. So we shut down, we had shot all of 5 episodes in 2 days of episode 6 of an 8 episode series, you know? So for all of us, like we all wanted to get the show done because we thought we had something really special that we were working on, and we hoped the world was gonna love it. I think everybody in our particular case, everybody was just really excited to go back to work and finish this thing and see it through. So I don't think anyone was too concerned at that point about, is it fun or not fun? I have a friend who has a show up in Atlanta right now, and she said, you know, people they're rolling with it. Everyone's rolling with it. And like, they're finding their fun, and they're finding, you know, especially now with vaccines and being outside is a different equation even than it was for us, because even back then we still were following much stricter protocol. You know, they're finding their way back to it, I think.
Did you have rules for eating and drinking, and like, how did people manage to do that?
Mars?
I mean, I believe that what they did was they had all of the meals became individually wrapped and packaged, so there wasn't the like cafeteria line style flow, and everyone was socially distanced, and they were eating in waves as opposed to it being like the whole company breaks and goes to lunch for an hour together, and it's like lunch hour in high school, right? You know, you're like, oh, we all get to hang out together and have a good time. It was much more like it went in definite waves and pockets, and they had, you know, sometimes people were eating outside, and sometimes, you know, they were inside and, you know, very, very large spaces where people were still staying socially distanced while they were eating, anytime they had to remove their PPE.
Yeah. And same with craft services, all that became, normally craft services is kind of looks like, I don't know, you know, there's snacks out and there might be some fresh fruit cut up, and it became all individually wrapped and packaged stuff. And then anytime they could be, weather permitting, they could be outside, like they were outside. Anytime we could do anything, you know, where we weren't in an enclosed space, we took advantage of that.
Can you talk a little bit about like the beginning, like so when production was shut down in March and, you know, and how you kind of got to the testing strategy that you had?
Yeah, so we, there were a lot of calls that even we weren't on, again, because this was happening at the high level, because the unions had to agree to it. And in our case, I mean, there's a lot of unions, right? You have Writers Guild, Screen Actors Guild, IATSE, which is your below the line crew, Directors Guild, who am I missing? Producers Guild. I mean, there's, you know, so there was a lot, there were a lot of talks happening at, as you can imagine, an incredibly, incredibly high level. So what we did, I mean, we were lucky, we were able to put all of our editors at home and get them edit bays set up at home. And so we were able to do edit essentially through Zoom, which was wild and crazy, but it worked. And so we kept working while they were kind of solving at the higher level, because, you know, we were one of how many TV shows out there that had to figure out a way to go back in. So that quest was really on them. And then our show in particular, we were allowed to get, we got, each studio was allowed to pick a single show to kind of put ahead of the big union deal that was going to happen, and it was our show in the case of Warner Horizon. And so we kind of had to hit pedal to the metal on that. And so we had a lot of calls about testing and how it was going to work. That fell largely on our line producer and our unit production manager. They're kind of the physical production people within an actual production. And so that really fell to them to kind of figure out how to make it all work. And so they spent a great deal of time from probably late April until we were back in. They spent a great deal of time, a lot of phone calls and lots of doctors and lots of scientists and people weighing in.
Marcy, do you have any?
No. I mean, yeah, that was kind of the way that we ended up evolving it, and, you know, just wanted to try to put the most parameters in place where we could clearly turn the lights back on, but also everyone could feel that they were covered, you know, that they were not walking into a scary, you know, that we were managing the situation, and that everyone felt like they were being taken care of.
Do you have any advice for, well, I have a question before asking like a broader one, but I mean, so different studios put forth one show. What about like, you know, less resourced productions, you know, how did testing work, or were they just unable to continue?
I don't know if I've heard of anyone not actually continuing. I feel like everything, right, Mars? I haven't heard of
anyone. Yeah, I don't know off the top of my head. I mean, I know, like I said, there were some productions, and I definitely know of some like smaller indie type things that they really did that. They built a bubble, and that was how they handled it. They had their crew, they had their cast, they had their writers, their directors, their producers, and they basically tested, went into the bubble. And I don't know if they ended up continuing doing, you know, testing as they went or not, but they basically locked themselves down and said, you know, for 10 days or 12 days or 25 days or however many days they were going to be shooting, nobody was going in or out. And they were treating it like one little shutdown household unit, basically, was the work unit. And they weren't going and visiting their families. They weren't going back and forth and just not cross-pollinating. And that was how I know of a couple of friends who did indie films that way. Yeah. During the pandemic and stuff, but.
Yeah. So kind of an overarching question, like what kind of advice would you give, you know, and what kind of advice would you give to others as they're thinking of like how to prepare in the future for another outbreak? And what do you think is like some of the biggest lessons that, you know, you really wish that, that, you know, we want to make sure we preserve so that we don't, you know, forget how, you know, we can get back to work a little bit more quickly.
Mars, do you want to?
It could be on a small level or, you know, big level.
I mean, I'm trying to, it's kind of like, I think that this was it definitely felt once in a generation type thing.
Let's hope
and
so.
And I'm hopefully, knock wood. Where everyone came together, and it feels like we've done our best to figure out the best way through this very, very challenging time for everyone. And now we are really hoping that we're turning the corner, starting to turn the corner. And I mean, I guess the space is, if it, God forbid, happens again, that we all now have some policies in place, and hopefully we'll be able to step into that even faster and put those guardrails up if we need to snap them back into place again. It felt very much like this time when it all started, everyone was completely flat-footed in that place of, it had never happened before. What was this, you know? And I mean, that was clearly across the globe. And I feel like hopefully what we gain out of that is now we feel like we have some policies that have worked and have worked well, and guidelines and guardrails, so that we can clip them back in if we need to.
I think for me, my takeaways are a little bit, Marcy and I are production-friendly writers and producers. Not everybody is, we are. I think we were already pretty nimble. This taught us to be a lot more nimble. And I think that is a takeaway that I hope every production will take with them of, you know, when the thing that comes out of left field comes out of left field, you just figure out how to mitigate through it as quickly as possible. And now that, and I do think there are some lessons learned in this of like, okay, stop, get everybody on the same page. If we need a smaller crew, we do a smaller crew. If we need to change the location, we can change the location. There are ways to do this, you know, and make it happen. So I think, you know, there are some practices in Hollywood that have existed for years, forever. And it's, the answer is always like, well, that's just because that's, you know, how it's always been done. And I think that now there's a way to challenge some of those practices, and not in a take on the machine way, but just in a like, no, like, look, I think you'll hear people say, you know, during COVID, we did this thing and it saved us like 6 hours on a day. And I do think some of those practices will carry forward. I certainly hope so. And then I do think also, the thing I said before, I really hope this has everybody, you know, looking out for people's health in a slightly different way than we certainly have in the past. And, you know, that's from whoever on set all the way up to the top and down to the bottom. So, you know, that you're a little more aware, even as an individual, that you're more aware of, I'm feeling a little funky, like, yeah, you know what, now it's not gonna be so weird to put on a mask. You know, many countries have done that for a long time. And I think there are lessons to be learned from that as well. So we'll see. We'll see if we all choose to do that or not.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see.
It's been such a pleasure to hear your stories of the, and I'm really so excited to that I had to prepare for this, that I had to actually watch your show. So it was really such a great experience, and thank you for all the joy that you bring. And it really has been so informative, and we are so grateful that you took time out of your very busy schedules to talk with us about testing.
So and thank you so much
for having us.
Back at all of you who have been the people solving these problems for the last, you know, 15 months, like, hats off to you, because if you all didn't do what you do for a living, there's no chance we would have been back in production. So we're very, very grateful to all of the science folks and medical folks out there who just figured it out.
So thank you so much, everyone. And well, that concludes our webinar for today, and we'll put everything on our website so you can review the recording, and we'll make sure that we send it to people who weren't able to join us. Sorry if we didn't get to your question, but hopefully we'll answer it in some other ways another time. Thank you, everyone, and thank you especially Meredith and Marcy. Take care, everybody.
All right, take care.